Okay, good morning. Welcome to the Roy Branson Legacy Sabbath School. And one of the things I wanted to tell you before we get going is that the money that some of you have donated, I want to thank you so much for it. We have brand new camera equipment that is owned by the Sabbath School. And we also have a new sound system that has yet to be hooked up. And it promises to not, you know, at inopportune times. That we will start using probably next week. But the new camera equipment has a very nice boom mic. So if you're speaking over here and with your questions, it will be able to pick that up. And so it promises to have a much better YouTube experience for those who watch it that way. This morning, I want to welcome Ron Graybill. Those of you who come routinely or watch on YouTube are well aware of him. He is a historian, and he focuses on the 19th century religion, and particularly the different, the Adventist movement. And I'm going to turn the time over to him.
Thank you very much. I thought I might begin just by updating you on some of the projects I've been working on. Very soon in Adventist Today, my article on the dream life of Ellen White will be published. I think you'll find that interesting. Many moons ago, you remember, I talked to you about the Teal Bible, the big Bible. And just this week, finally, I've gotten the last report on the 30th Teal Bible, where I've been analyzing all the engravings that are in this volume. And I didn't have the, I knew there was a Bible at the University of Michigan, but I couldn't find anybody to go in there and look at it. But one of the librarians in the religion department did it for me, and she was very pleased to do that. So that one is up to date. And then, you know, I've been talking about Ellen White's handwriting and her handwritten manuscripts, the holographic manuscripts. Well, David Trim, who was the archivist for the General Conference and who was here last week, is planning a conference on Adventist history in January of 2018 in conjunction with the American Historical Association Conference, which will be meeting in Washington at the same time. So, and the topic was to put Adventism in context. And so I'm thinking about my study of Ellen White's handwriting, and I said, oh, I know what to do. I'll have a paper to present to them, and it will be about the role of diary keeping in the 19th century and the role of letters in the 19th century. And then I can weave in the stuff about Mrs. White. You know, we have a number of Adventist diaries other than Ellen White's. Ellen White was just one, you know. We have Angela Andrews' diary is over here in our heritage room. And then we have an Amidon diary, we have a Loughborough diary. So we'll compare her as a diarist with those others. Now, today, Dave Larson sometimes gets a little bit enthusiastic when he announces these topics, and he waxes eloquent on what I'm going to talk about, and he seemed to imply that I was going to cover the utopian movements of the 19th century very broadly. No, I'm not. I'm going to go very deeply into the life of one person impacted by these utopian movements. But, you know, once he mentioned that, I went on Wikipedia to say, yeah, I guess there were a lot of utopian movements. So I just worked out a list of them, and some I'd never heard about. For instance, there's one called the Prairie Home Community. It wasn't in Garrison Keillor's hometown. And they were actually a bunch of spiritualists who decided that they should move their buildings down by the banks of the Ohio River just weeks before one of the worst floods ever. And it washed, they were all in this building, and it washed away one wall, and they were mostly spiritualists, and most of them got spirited away by the floodwaters. So, now we will begin what I want to do for my lecture today. In 1883, Mrs. White wrote, "Brother Wayland's health has been very poor, but he is improving since I gave him Mrs. Temple's remedy." Then on another occasion, "Fanny has been suffering greatly. She has now been using Mrs. Temple's remedy and is having relief." Another occasion, "I send you Mrs. Temple's remedy. Be sure to have Reba take it." And then she seems to have lost the recipe. She writes, "Will you inquire if anyone in our family has the recipe for Mrs. Temple's remedy or the recipe for cholera mixture?" Now, the amazing thing is, you know, in my article about Ellen White's dream life, I note that often these dreams are on topics that she's concerned about or reading about or, you know, that are current. And the same is true of our dreams, but the same would also be true if her dreams were given by God, because naturally he would be answering questions that were relevant to her. And you know, she read about the health reformers and she made a lot of health reform advice. She never claims to have had any vision or any dream or to make any recommendation in published that we should all be taking Mrs. Temple's remedy. So I thought that was kind of it. But anyway, we do have it. So who was Mrs. Temple? This is the question. At first I thought, well, maybe this is just a brand name for a patent medicine. But no, there was a real Mrs. Temple, and her remedy can tell us something about the mid-19th century world in which Seventh-day Adventists emerged. So let's look at the setting that brought Mrs. Temple's remedy into Mrs. White's medicine cabinet. Now, as we've been saying, the second quarter of the 19th century was a time of great promise and peril and passion. The new steam presses were spewing out thousands of cheap pamphlets and newspapers and books. And the railroads were expanding. The telegraph was spreading across the country. The old political order was shattered with the election of Andrew Jackson in 1828. Jackson was a racist outsider, you know, and he was elected. And our new president has a picture of Andrew Jackson in his office now. So Jackson's enemies no doubt exaggerated the chaos at the White House party after the inauguration, but this is what they said. "What a scene did we witness. The majesty of the people had disappeared, and the rabble, a mob of boys, Negroes, women, children, scrambling, fighting, romping. What a pity, what a pity. No arrangements had been made, no police officers on duty, and the whole house inundated by a rabble mob. Basket of deplorables, indeed." Well, and of course, at the time, Orthodox medicine was under attack. All kinds of new medical doctrines were being circulated. There were all kinds of reforms: dress reform, prison reform, asylum reform, health reform, peace movements, anti-slavery movements. And people thought, oh my, things are getting so much better, at least the optimists thought so, that the millennium would soon dawn. And they believed that once the millennium dawned and 1,000, and we had, at least in America, had 1,000 years of peace, then Jesus would return. And so they were called post-millennialists, because Jesus' return was to be after the millennium. Well, the Millerites would have none of that. They were pre-millennialists. They believed the world was getting worse and worse, and Jesus would have to come to bring in the millennium. Now, I think that we might observe that premillennialists, I got to say this slowly because this is a hard word, premillennialists and postmillennialists were very much alike, because they both believed that Jesus was, that the millennium was coming soon, and they both believed that human efforts were essential to bringing it about. In a sense, the only true premillennialists were the Millerites, because they said Jesus is coming October 23, or 22, yeah, I got off by a day too. October 20, what?
This was a great disappointment.
It was good, yeah. 1844, and there was nothing we could do about it. We just had to get ready for it. There's nothing that we would do that would hasten or delay the coming of Christ. But once that happened, then people got saying, well, now why hasn't Jesus come? What has to happen before? Well, let's form a utopian community. Maybe the problem in society today is the problem of exclusive marriage. Let's get rid of that. And so at Oneida, they had complex marriage. Theoretically, everybody is married to everybody else. You say, my goodness, what an orgy of... Not at all, not at all, folks. The elders of the community, all men, would decide who would couple with whom. And they believed that older people were more spiritually mature than younger people. So if two young people had sex, they were corrupting each other. Young men needed to couple with old women, and old men needed to couple with young women. This was not nearly as much fun as some people might have thought. But the Shakers went the opposite direction. They were celibate. And it's very interesting. The Shakers were also very much for the equality of men and women. Now, it is true that there were certain tasks in the Shaker villages that were predominantly done by women. But for instance, Shakers, because they weren't growing biologically, they would take in orphan children. And so they had people appointed to take care of the children. And those appointed to take care of the children were a man and a woman. Not just women took care of the little children. And so the celibacy is turned out in the utopian community. Celibacy was more advantageous for women than some of these other arrangements. And of course the Mormons, they had polygamy. And then there was another utopian community, the Seventh-day Adventists, and they believed that they should model correct Sabbath keeping. And if eventually they perfectly represented the character of Christ, then and only then would Christ return to claim them as his own. So there was a sense in which Adventists need to reach millennial perfection before Christ can come. So there's a sense in which Adventists who take that statement literally are kind of post-millennialists. But I want to look particularly at the Shakers. The United Society of Believers in Christ's Second Appearing were a Christian sect founded in 18th century England, and then the Shakers came to America in 1774 under the leadership of Mother Ann Lee. Now, her followers believe that Mother Ann Lee was imbued with the female element of divinity, just like Jesus was imbued with the male element of divinity. So in a sense, Mother Ann Lee was the second coming. There was the second coming, was Mother Ann Lee, and the Shakers actually believed they were already in the millennium. They had 1,000 years to perfect their furniture, and so they took time. No, they took time, and you know, the Shakers were one of the longest lived of the utopian communities. In fact, I think there's probably a half a dozen of them still at Sabbath Day Lake in Maine. But anyway, the Shakers celebrated a communal lifestyle, pacifism, equality of the sexes. And then during the middle of the 19th century, they experienced what has been called the era of manifestations, which included visions and trances for young women. Now, in Cincinnati, Ohio, we had Enoch Jacobs, who was the editor of the Millerite newspaper, the Day Star. And Jacobs had already exhibited an interest in visionary trances of young women when he published Ellen Harmon's first vision in January of 1846. 6 months later, Enoch Jacobs had joined the Shakers. Now, he was one of some 200 Adventists who joined the Shakers. Most of them didn't stay more than a year or two. But the Shakers actively recruited Adventists. And of course, especially to these spiritualizing Adventists, Shakerism would kind of appeal because like the Shaker, he had come spiritually. Well, he came spiritually in the person of Mother Ann Lee or whatever. So we think that most of those who Adventists who joined the Shakers were of that sort. But the Shakers actively recruited Adventists. They attended the meetings. They brought wagon loads of Adventists to their villages to have a look. Now, Jacobs himself was expelled from the Shaker community for violating the rule of celibacy. He declared that he would rather go to hell with Electra, his wife, than to live among the Shakers without her. So, this is where we begin to get the story of Mrs. Temple's remedy. Elizabeth Temple was born Elizabeth White in Goshen, New Hampshire. Now, if her middle name was Gertrude, her initials would have been EGW before she got married. But we don't know what her middle name was. At any rate, Samuel and Sarah White had a baby girl in 1809, whom they named Elizabeth. This means she was nearly 20 years older than Ellen White, who was not born until 1827. Now, both Ellen and Elizabeth ended up marrying a man by the name of James. It was about 1834 when Elizabeth married James Lyman Temple, who generally used his middle name, Lyman. So the couple had two sons, Lyman Jr. and Israel. Now, the Temples were Millerites. At least Elizabeth was. And we don't hear much about her actual Millerite experience, but about a half a dozen years later, she was very, very ill. And Otis Nichols, who was a friend of the Whites and very prominent in early Adventism, Otis Nichols and his wife Mary, they hastened to Boston to have to anoint and pray for Elizabeth Temple. So they come in and they find that Elizabeth's brother was there, and he's not a believer. So they put him and ask him to leave the room before they pray. I don't know, any of you ministers ever did an anointing in prayer and had to ask, did you ask non-believers to leave the room? I don't know, that's what he did. Not only that, but when Mary was going to do the anointing, and Otis was going to do the praying, and Mary anointed her, not on the forehead, like we used to anoint, no, on her abdomen, because that's where she was feeling the pain. And she was healed instantly, and the next day the Nichols came by and she was walking around the house singing and praising God. Now, we learn a great deal about Elizabeth Temple once we can identify the mysterious Sister M in Ellen White's Testimonies for the Church, Volume 2. Now, most of you probably know that in the testimonies, the names of the actual individuals addressed have been left out, and in their place it's, you know, it starts with Sister Brother A, Brother B, Brother C, Sister A, B, C, and Sister M. So when you get to Sister M, you start noticing some clues as to this woman's identity. She lived in Boston. She had a violently abusive alcoholic husband. She had two sons who served in and survived the American Civil War. She was poor much of her early married life, and then she became rich. Every line of that testimony fits this woman perfectly. Apparently, Elizabeth's marriage began well enough. Her husband, Mrs. White says, was an affectionate, noble-minded man. However, intoxicating drink benumbed his brain, and he became a hopeless alcoholic. For much of their marriage, he subjected her to persecution, threats, and violence. This is why I call her a battered woman. Probably he struck her. Elizabeth struggled with poverty, working as a housekeeper to try to get food for herself and her children. The couple lived apart part of the time, maybe for long periods. In 1855, we find James living in a boarding house and then Elizabeth with her younger son living elsewhere. By the early 60s, James Lyman Temple had died. But Mrs. White provides another interesting detail about Sister M. She spent time with the Shakers. Now, we don't know when she sojourned with the Shakers, but if it was in the 1840s, it would fit, because Mrs. White wrote, "Some of the Shakers had received spiritual manifestations telling them that you were designed of God to be a prominent member of their society. Now, it was common for poverty-stricken men and women this era, when facing a hard winter, to go among the Shakers just to have food and shelter during the wintertime. And the Shakers did not reject them, because this is the way they grew, by, you know, being open and friendly to people who might want to join them. And then in the summertime, these winter Shakers, as they were called, would go on their way, but maybe a few of them would stay. So what had happened is some of Elizabeth's Adventist friends, who had sort of helped her out in her poverty, they had joined the Shakers, and so she joined the Shakers. Now, we remember the Shakers for their elegant furniture, but in Elizabeth's day, they were better known as the nation's chief source of medicinal herbs. They shipped to apothecaries, drugstores, doctors, individuals, tons, literally tons of medicinal herbs. And it's easy to imagine that Elizabeth might have been put to work harvesting, drying, powdering, packaging, and shipping herbs around the country. Now, even if she wasn't directly involved in the business, she would have had time to observe it. Then Mrs. White wrote, "The Lord opened the way for you to leave that deceived community, and you left unharmed the principles of your faith as pure as when you went among them." Now, shortly after she left the Shakers, Elizabeth was very ill again, and this time James and Ellen White were passing through Boston. They prayed for her, and she was again healed. At the time you felt a decided change. Joy and gladness filled your heart. The praise of God was upon your lips. Oh, what hath the Lord wrought, was the sentiment of your soul. Echoing the title of our textbook, What Hath God Wrought? She didn't quite quote it right, did she? Okay. At some point, Mrs. Temple concocted her own herbal remedy, mixed it together, mixed it with some water, tried it on her family, tried it on her friends. They seemed to think it was helping them. By the way, if you watch that video on patent medicines, one of the things they say that people at that time thought that the more bitter it was, the better it was. Had to be good. Had to be good if it was bitter. And so anyway, she probably figured, well, if the Shakers can make money on it, so can I. So she had some bottles made with her name embossed on them. You're going to get a closer look at this later. But, you know, on the side it says Mrs. Temple's, quote, renovating remedy. And then it says Boston, Massachusetts. So she had a bunch of these bottles made. I'm desperately trying to find one to buy, but Jim Nix is also, so I'm in competition with him. But anyway, she had these bottles made, and she went into business. By 1864, she had sold 5,000 bottles of the brew. She even had some brown stoneware jugs made with her name stamped on them for customers who wanted to supersize. And thanks to my research, there were two of these jugs for sale on eBay, and thanks to my research, was resurrecting Elizabeth Temple from the ashes of history, Jim Nix has purchased both of them. So I can't. But you know, brew is not exactly the right word to describe Mrs. Temple's remedy, because unlike most patent medicines of the day, she said that hers had no alcohol in it. Now, we should insert here parenthetically that the other recipe Mrs. White mentioned wanting a copy of, the cholera mixture, was quite different. It had a liberal dose of brandy and a bit of opium in the form of laudanum as well. Thank God she didn't have a vision on that. But anyway, even as her medicinal business grew, Elizabeth realized another blessing. A little combat, but the older one was with General Grant in several battles, including the incredibly bloody Battle of Cold Harbor. But Lyman Temple was not one of the 13,000 Union soldiers killed in that one battle. He and his brother called it good luck, but Ellen White said, a mother's prayers from an anxious, burdened soul had much to do with their preservation. So, what was in Mrs. Temple's renovating remedy? Well, we don't know exactly what was in these bottles, but we do know the recipe that Mrs. White had, and probably got it directly from Mrs. Temple. So pasted in the back of her 1892 diary, along with the recipe for cholera mixture, was the recipe for Mrs. Temple's remedy. Gentane, 5 ounces. Bloodroot, 5 ounces. Seabibs or cubibs, 3 ounces. Snake root, 3 ounces. All should be powdered finely and then mixed together. And for use, take 1 teaspoonful of fine powder and steep it in a pint of hot water. The dose is a tablespoonful 3 or 4 times a day before or after meals as is convenient. Now, it's interesting, these herbs are still for sale today. You can order them. You probably get some of them over here at Clark's Nutrition Center, is that what they call it? And in this book on Shaker Medicinal Herbs, three of the 4 that she mentions in her remedy are here. And there seems to be responsible evidence that these particular herbs have some medicinal value. In fact, 1 or 2 of them is reviewed on WebMD. And so we should get a hold of this stuff. And the next time I lecture, we should have a bunch of these little paper cups. And we'll add some Welch's grape juice, and we'll have our own communion here with Mrs. Temple's remedy. Well, we'll certainly need the grape juice, because how did it taste? Well, one of Mrs. White's young secretaries in Australia, Edna Kilbourne Steele, had moved here to Loma Linda in her old age, and she remembered Mrs. Temple's remedy and wrote to the White Estate to see if she could get a copy of the recipe. And she said, they couldn't find it at that time, but we have found it since. But anyway, she said, Sir McAtoofer used to make this for her, for Mrs. White, and it seemed to be a sort of general cure-all, tonic or something, that she, Sister White, indulged in quite frequently, with apparent good results. At least I remember she had much faith in the brew, which was the bitterest stuff imaginable. In fact, it was terrible, for it stayed in the mouth so long, that bitterness. Well, it wasn't only Ellen White who believed in it. In 1864, Mrs. Temple published a 24-page pamphlet full of testimonials from her customers. They claim to have been cured of scrofulous humors, scarlet fever, consumption, sore eyes, ulcerated kidneys, rheumatism, dropsy, dyspepsia, numbness, erysipelas, and insanity. One mother wrote of her darling little boy, 4 years old, on the point of death. He started taking it, and the first day he started taking it, he started crying out for bread, and before he had finished 1 bottle, he was able to walk around the house. Well, Mrs. Temple's business was really thriving in 1866 when she published another pamphlet. And with the help of friends and the internet and so on, this is the cover of the 1866 pamphlet. And you notice by this time she's hired a full-time salesman. Thomas Bond is a general traveling agent out of Boston, and then she puts blank lines here so she can fill in the names by hand of local agents, whoever's selling it in Portland, and so on and so forth. So she's going great guns by 1866. Let's see here. Okay. Oh, it's on this page here. Now, in this pamphlet, we learn that a single bottle would cost $1, which was equal to about 25 bucks in today's money. And although some maladies could be cured with a single bottle, if you had a chronic condition, you needed to take it for a whole year. It's no wonder Mrs. Temple got rich. But Mrs. White's interest in Mrs. Temple was not just about her bitter remedy, it was about the money she was making and the impact it was having on her spiritual life. Now, in the book we're studying, you know, Daniel Walker Howe's What Hath God Wrought, the author cites a foreign visitor's observations about America during this period. Most observers at the time found Americans obsessively preoccupied with earning a living. Charles Dickens angered his host by complaining about the overwhelmingly commercial tone of American life, the worship of the almighty dollar. Americans pursued success so avidly they seemed to seldom pause to smell the flowers, or in Mrs. Temple's case, to attend to her spiritual life. Kind of raw egotism, unsoftened by sociability, expressed itself in boastful men demanding women and loud children. Now, Mrs. White said that God had tested Sister Temple with poverty and suffering in her early married life, and she had passed that test admirably. But now he had decided to test her with prosperity, and she wasn't doing so well. Now, she's not the only one, because, you know, I've been proofreading the early testimonies all through the 50s and 60s, again and again. Mrs. White is writing to this farmer or this merchant or whatever, this Adventist, and saying, you know, you're neglecting your spiritual life. You're just spending all your time trying to make money. So what Charles Dickens observed was true of the Adventists as well, and their spiritual lives. So, you know, John Wesley observed, "I do not see how it is possible in the nature of things for any true religion to continue long." And I think he means religious experience. "For religion must necessarily produce industry and frugality, and this cannot but produce riches. But as riches increase, so will love of the world in all of its branches." And Mrs. Temple does seem to have wandered from her Adventist faith in these years. During her years of poverty, Elizabeth maintained her subscription to the Advent Review. She would pay $1 or $2 a year to keep that coming, but she would contribute little else. Then, when her fortunes turned and she first started making money in 1863, she became very generous with the church. She paid $10 to get more than a dozen copies of the new prophetic chart so she could share it with friends and prospective converts. In 1864, she made several large donations, so large that in today's money they would probably be worth nearly $700. She even remembered her earlier ambition to help the poor, and she offered discounts on the price of her remedy for poor people. But after mid-1866, when this pamphlet appeared, proudly boasting that it was the greatest medicine of the age, her donations to the church ceased. She doesn't even appear to maintain her subscription to the Advent Review. And in this pamphlet, unlike the one 2 years earlier, there's no mention of consideration for the poor. Now, you know, at 67, she even married Ransom Hicks, who in earlier years had been part of the Messenger Party, ferocious opponents of Ellen White. Hicks himself had compared Ellen White with Jezebel. Now, this marriage didn't last long, but she was stuck with his name on legal documents to the end of her life. But the marriage symbolized her spiritual declension. And Mrs. White described the role prosperity played in this decline. "As means came into your hands, I saw you gradually and almost imperceptibly separating from God. The means entrusted to you were experienced for your own convenience to surround yourself with the good things of life. The business and cares of your new position claimed your time and attention, and your duty to God was not considered." And Mrs. Temple did feel that, you know, as a prosperous businesswoman, she needed to upgrade her home and upgrade her wardrobe. And there was an additional factor. Her son Lyman had married, and his wife objected to Elizabeth praying out loud during family devotions. And so Elizabeth abandoned family worship. By 18, 68, she had divorced Hicks. And the Whites on an Eastern tour stopped in Boston and visited her. Now, we don't know what transpired during this visit, but I can imagine that the Whites made some very touching appeals and that Sister Temple made some very heartfelt confessions. And Mrs. White wrote, "We left Boston and Sister Temple yesterday about noon. We hope now her long state of inactivity will end and she be again an interested worker in the cause of God, as she has been." And arriving home, James White wrote, "The Lord is doing a great work for this woman who is consecrating herself anew to God." Now, after she got home, Mrs. White mailed Elizabeth a long testimony, and she reviewed her whole life and urged her, you know, to do what she apparently had already committed to do, and that is to improve her spiritual life. Mrs. Temple responded in a letter to Mrs. White, which was then published in the review, "I received your testimony last evening, for which I thank the Lord. It is true. It seemed to spread my past experience, trials, and dealings of God afresh before my mind as though it was but yesterday. I could not have stated the facts more correctly. I read and wept until I had read them twice and commenced reading them a third time. What a change has come over me. What heavenly wisdom I need to be a just steward. How many times I felt to thank the Lord that, in His providence, you and Brother White came this way, and for your faithfulness, God will bless you and everyone who is faithfully trying to reach out to His lost sheep." And by the way, in a lot of the testimonies during this time, Mrs. White is urging ministers and lay people to reach out to former Adventists who are living in the community and try and win them back. "We had a good meeting yesterday where three children of the Rosen requested an interest in our prayers. May the Lord convert and lead them in the way everlasting." So in testimony for the church number 17, which appeared even before Mrs. Temple's confession could appear in the review, Mrs. White published that whole testimony to Mrs. Temple. Her name was blanked out, but I'm sure all the Adventists in Boston and most of the Adventists around the country probably knew exactly who she was, who was writing about. But almost immediately, they would have all seen her positive response to the testimony as well. Now, the final 15 years of Elizabeth Temple's life, she remained a faithful Adventist. She put a small ad in the 1870 Boston City Directory, and this ad restored the line, "The poor always liberally considered." Her enterprise did not seem to have continued at the same level, and she spent a good deal of money trying to set her sons up in the grocery business. But nevertheless, she maintained her subscription to the Advent Review, and she contributed a handsome $100 to help buy a printing press for Jan Andrews' missionary efforts in Europe. By 1876, she had moved out of town a few miles, but she was still the first to arrive at the Boston church for a day of fasting and prayer. "It was a blessed season," the pastor reported. Sister Temple paid it the highest compliment any pioneer Adventist could offer. This is an 1844 meeting," she said, "such as we experienced just prior to the 10th day of the 7th month." And you know, Mrs. White also described that period as the happiest year of her life, that year of anticipating that Jesus was coming just within a year. Well, we don't know much about the final years of Elizabeth Temple's life. The day after Christmas in 1884, she died and rests in the blessed hope. So that concludes my formal presentation, but I want you to have a closer look at some of these photographs and also to a photograph that shows the ingredients of the remedy. So we're passing out a set of several. So you look, goes through, and then as you're satisfied, you pass them along all the way along, and we'll get the sets over here at the end. So I didn't want you looking at that while I was trying to talk to you, but now you can. Okay, now, who has a question or a comment? Yes.
I was interested in your comment about the post-millennialists and the pre-millennialists having a lot in common. Can you expand on that a little more? You know, in my part that I studied on, there seemed to be a lot of this millennialism, during the Revolutionary War and leading up. So it just...
Yeah, I mean, this optimism that America was the chosen nation, it was a city set on the hill, it was where God meant to carry out his will on the earth, was pervasive, and so I don't think the people of that time thought of themselves in terms of pre or post or whatever. Things were getting better and better, Jesus was going to come soon, and so on. And my idea, and you can find flaws in it, but my idea that pre-millennialists ended up being a lot like the post-millennials, that hasn't been tested. But anyway, yeah, it was pervasive. Millennialism was everywhere, yes. Okay.
So what criteria did Mrs. Templeton use to gather these ingredients and put this together? She clearly was probably not trained as a physician. Did she consult experts, or did she just... How did she put all this together?
On
what basis? And was there anybody able to ascertain if this was effective or not on a scientific basis?
Well, here's the thing. Let me answer the last question first. Most diseases and maladies are self-limiting. So you're in pain or you're suffering from this, that, or the other. If you don't do anything, in a week or two, you're going to get better. The body is just that way. Now, but if you say, oh my goodness, I can't stand this, I'll take this to Temple's Remedy, and then you get better. So you think it's because you took Sister Temple's Remedy. But as I say, as I've looked at it, and I tried to get in touch with the people in the School of Pharmacy and see if we had an expert who would really look into it in depth. But the specific ingredients in Mrs. Temple's Remedy seem to actually have some medicinal benefits. Now, maybe she just luckily struck on... You know, the Shakers also... sold tonics and patent medicines. They're called patent medicines. They weren't all patented by any means, but they're just called patent medicines. So they also said that, so she may just be imitating something that she saw there. Or she may have some old Shaker lady standing there and say, this one is especially good, and this one is especially good. And so, I can't prove she got her ideas from the Shaker, but it seems so likely, because, that's that was the source of those period of time. Question here.
When I think of the Shakers, at least modern day Shakers, I sort of think of education, especially in the grade schools. Where did they get into education?
Well,
or the Quakers. I'm talking about the Quakers. Are the Quakers and Shakers very closely?
Well, the Shakers kind of grew out of the Quakers. And at first they were called the Shaking Quakers because of their dances, Somebody said that the shaking was trying to shake the evil out of them, I don't know. But at any rate, so there was an affiliation between the Shakers and the Quakers. And unlike the Amish, for instance, who were eschewed all modern inventions, the Shakers were just the opposite. They would accept any... and they invented a lot of things, and they wanted modern conveniences, and before long they were driving cars and not just using carriages. So I think that they were open to new ideas. They realized that these children ought to be educated, and so they had schools, and they had male teachers and female teachers and so on. So they were very innovative and very advanced for their time, which may be part of the reason why they did survive so long. You'd think, if you're totally celibate and you're not having any children, you would die out more quickly. But there were a lot of women like Elizabeth Temple who may have discovered that marriage was not all that great after all. And, Shaker community was not all that bad. Okay, other Comments or questions? Oh, over here, yes.
Comment and a question. At the Huntington, they recently had an exhibit on early American art, and they had shaker boxes, which are these round boxes, really, really cool, really elegant. And the question is, do you have any idea how the shakers got into herbalism in such a significant way?
Yes.
How did that come about?
Well, you know, I really don't know what the early influences were. You know, they were trying to be self-sustained anyway. So they were raising vegetables, and they were selling seeds for fruits and vegetables as well as this. And so I suppose it was just common in that day for people to use herbal remedies. And they discovered they could make a little money on it, so then it grew. But I'm just guessing. There are a lot of videos on YouTube about the Shakers, and many of the finest ones are about the Hancock Shaker Village, which was in Massachusetts. And I suspect that Elizabeth Temple probably did go to the Hancock Village, because it was closest to her. And even in these videos, there's wonderful videos about the making of those boxes, about the making of their furniture. And Hancock Village, after the Shakers kind of abandoned it, was purchased by a nonprofit and completely restored, and it's a wonderful museum. In fact, on YouTube, you can watch the orientation video that you would see if you went to Hancock to look around. So it's really quite beautiful and entertaining to look at some of those videos. And by the way, I'm sure there are videos on some of these other utopian communities as well. There's Neshoba, New Harmony, New Philadelphia, Oberlin, Brook Farm, North American Flanks, Hopedale, Fruitland, Sodus Bay, Wisconsin Flanks, Claremont Flanks, Prairie Home Community, as we mentioned, Christine Community, Spring Farm Colony, Oneida Community, Acarians, Amana Colonies. That's interesting that both Amana and Oneida are still with us today in the form of refrigerators. Is there other?
Silverware.
Well, silverware from Oneida, but Amana appliances. Yeah. Brereton Bay Union, Free Lovers at Davis House. maybe they were more orgiastic than Oneida, I don't know. The Reunion Colony, the Octagon City, the Working Man's Cooperative Colony, the Danish Socialist Colony. Yeah, we'll have to check that one out. And the Shalom Community. So what you do, you go to Wikipedia and just put in Utopian Communities, and there'll be this whole list. And some of them will be hyperlinked, and then you can go to articles about them, and then you can go to YouTube and put in the name Free Lovers at Davis House and see the original pornographic videos.
I was wondering if you knew how they grew the herbs, or did they go out and just collect the herbs?
Oh, that's interesting that you asked. They did both. They had very neat gardens, very well tended, and they would have to have grown lots of herbs to have the volume of business that they had. But they also went out in the woods and collected herbs. This same woman, this Edna Steele, who was with Mrs. White, elsewhere in that letter she says, you know, whenever we would go out on a carriage ride with Mrs. White there in Australia, and we would see some red clover, she would get us out of the carriage, and we would have to gather a whole basket of red clover or mullein or something. You know, whenever Mrs. White spotted a herb, then the girls would get out and pick it.
You don't mention any connection with India, but isn't it possible they could have learned something from the native population?
Oh, you know, Native Americans.
Yeah, Native Americans.
Well, when you first said Indian, one of these ingredients has been used as a medicinal herb in India for many years. But you're talking about Native Americans. You know, You know, it is possible, because the other thing about the Shakers is they were open to having African Americans, Native Americans. They were welcoming of all sorts of people. So that would be interesting to see if there's Native Americans who joined their group, or they might have just consulted with the Native Americans and say, you know, what do you use this for? Back row, and then you.
Oh, I was just wondering about hallucinogenics. Were they ingredients in any of this stuff? Or?
You know, you'd have to look through. There's a long list of Shaker herbs in the back here, and you'd have to look through and see if any of them were hallucinogenic. When I was doing the after-school program over here in San Bernardino, we used to go out and we would try to teach them about the plants and animals, and there would be jimson wheat, you know. And I would say to the kids, now, this is deadly poison. Some kids, and the Indians used it to get high, but the Indians knew how to use it without killing themselves. Then I started to think, yeah, the ones that survived, the only ones that told the story, because it's said that every year or two, some teenager who hears that this will get you high, he goes out and takes some of these things and grinds them up and tries to get high on Datura, or?
Yeah,
Datura. Yeah, Datura. And kills himself. So I don't know to what extent these were hallucinogenic. I don't think the ones that Mrs. Temple used were hallucinogenic. But you know, right along with the business of if it was bitter, it must be good, doctors at the time were doing almost anything that would cause a reaction. And so we criticized them for using strychnine and arsenic and so on and so forth, but they were just trying to get some kind of reaction out of the body, hoping that would help. And so that would be interesting to know if the Shakers dances were inspired by an early form of ecstasy. Oh yeah, another question.
When I was in Washington, I read an article about the Utopian Trail, and it listed seven or eight of these Utopian societies in western Illinois and into Iowa. Now, and was there, so I got the impression that there was a certain congregation, and it was interesting about the spiritualists along wherever they were in that area. Are you aware that there was a especially great draw of these kind of people into the Midwest in that area there?
Well, here's what you find. Americans moved west in climatic belts. So if you were in New England and grandfather's farm was divided up among his sons, and then the sons and the farms were now too small to support the family, these folks would move, but they would move to western New York and then to Michigan, just the same route that the Adventist Church takes, and then they would move to Iowa and Wisconsin, Minnesota, and so on. An interesting thing, if you the Mormons, you know, with their ancestry.com, and they're making a lot of money now by checking your DNA and finding out. And so they've taken these hundreds of thousands of DNA samples, and they've sort of charted where these people lived in the United States. And you can see those are going west. And so in Michigan, for instance, the farmers were raising cattle for beef and wheat, and they came from western New York and New England. But in Indiana, which is the next state down, they were raising hogs and corn, and they came from Maryland and Pennsylvania. So even just there, you can see them moving in that direction. So yes, spiritualism was moving, and utopianism was moving, and different farming practices were moving, And so it's not surprising that in Iowa and in Illinois and so on, we would see manifestations of these things. Now that list in Wikipedia also lists where these people were, and so you can look and see which ones, and it would be interesting to see if the ones in the Midwest are all starting just a little bit later than the ones in the East. Probably they would. Okay, how are we doing? 11:27, we have 3 minutes left.
I'm being the devil's advocate. We know about placebo effect, we know about mass gullibility, and you know, now we have an FDA to keep all this in order. And so people that are producing food supplements or tonics or whatever, there's some control governmentally, good or bad. But then you go to other cultures where some of the traditional medical practices, from our Western perspective, are demonic, destructive, life-destroying. You know, how many people died in the era you're speaking about with somebody's vision about something or other that was deadly?
Yeah, I really don't know, but I'm sure that if we looked at the ingredients of a large number of these patent medicines, we would find some things in them that were definitely detrimental. There is, as you mentioned, on the positive side, there is also that placebo effect. If I read this pamphlet and find out how even my insanity can be cured by taking this stuff, and I start taking it, I might figure I should calm down a little. Okay? Yeah?
A long time ago when I was a student at CUC, went on the New England study tour, and we did go to the Shaker Village, and I remember it being a pretty remarkable place. Their furniture making is really quite remarkable. But the one thing all of us college students thought was weird was the notion of they can't marry. So we just wondered about their survival. But they're truly an industrious people. And we were quite impressed with the, I think it was what, Hancock Village?
Yeah. No, and I think they would bring in orphans, but when the orphans turned 18, they got to choose whether they would stay or not. So they weren't trying to, you know, force them to stay. But many of them, this would be by that time the only life they knew. That would be their community. They actually referred to groups as families. You know, at Hancock Village, there's this huge dwelling house, and there's a stairway for the men to their side, and a stairway for the women to their side. But when you get up to the attic and the slope of the roof, there's not room for two stairways. And the women would store the winter clothes up there in the loft and then the summer clothes. And so the women would be the ones who would go up and down that last stairway. And the fellow was showing, you know, on the banister comes down like this, and then there's, I don't know what it's called at the end of the banister. And you could see, he showed that the side that the men would have climbed the stairs was much less worn than the side where the women would have climbed the stairs. But by taking in orphans, by welcoming people who were, having trouble of one sort or another, and other people just, you know, they got there and they thought, well, man, these people are doing a lot more prosperous than I'm doing on my miserable farm. I better come here. So, you know, somehow they survived. Somehow they survived. Okay, well, if you, I think the pictures have all probably gotten down to this end, but as a prize, if you want to take one of those pictures with you for a souvenir of our wonderful time here today, you're welcome to do that. Otherwise, I'll collect them and take them back for my next lecture. Okay. Now, okay.
All right, we'll end with our normal benediction. The
Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you.
We'll cover it. And
we have a new, you're going to be the first subject of our new video system.
Oh, good.
With a boom mic on it. But we're still going to give this to you.
Oh, cool. You know, here's the thing. Where will you sit?
I'm sitting over there unless you need me to sit somewhere else.
Here's what I want you to do. I don't want you to let anybody see these.
Okay.
Until when I finish.
Did you hear what you said about the church broadcasting?
Streaming.
What's her name?
Grocery store the other day, you know, you check out the